Hello, friends. I'm Elder Keith Ellis, pastor of Paradise Primitive Baptist Church in Arlington, Texas. Today, I would like to take a look at close communion. Typically, most people don't understand the principle of close communion and become offended by it. Communion is one of only two ordinances delivered to the church, the other being baptism, which is one prerequisite to be admitted to communion. First, let's take a look at communion and its biblical purpose. And he took bread and gave thanks and broke it, and gave unto them, saying, This is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood which is shed for you. Luke 22:19-20. So we simply partake of the bread and wine which symbolize and bring to remembrance the Lord and how he sacrificed his body and shed his blood for us. This observance points us directly to the central theme of the gospel, Jesus Christ and him crucified. Now, there's nothing magical about this ordinance. These elements simply, yet profoundly, remind us of the gravity of what Jesus has done for us. The elements of unleavened bread and fermented wine are not transformed in any way. Most people don't argue that we should use anything other than unleavened bread, but many seem to lose sight that the wine is just as significant. Both of the elements are to be free of leaven, just as our Lord was free of sin. Grape juice doesn't fit the bill. Fermented wine does. Now, if you think that grape juice and saltine crackers are satisfactory elements to use in communion service, then why not go all the way and just use beer and pretzels? Because there's not any difference between them, all containing leaven. Now, someone might say, I prefer grape juice because I'm a recovering alcoholic. Now, if this were in any other setting, I would tell you not to partake. However, we must exercise faith in this matter. Trust God to keep you from falling. We don't have the right to change the elements because someone may be weak in the faith either. If you still feel that you couldn't drink wine because of your weakness, don't cause the entire church to stumble in this matter by insisting on grape juice. Next, we need to consider that it's the Lord's table where the elements are served from and not man's. This means that the Lord alone has a right to say who may eat at this table. Ye are they which have continued with me in my temptations, and I appoint unto you a kingdom as my Father hath appointed unto me, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Luke 22:28-30. Here the Lord appoints the right to eat at his table to those who are his servants and have persevered or continued with him through temptation. Does this apply to just anyone that walks through the door of the meeting house? Absolutely not. But now I have written unto you not to keep company, if any man that is called a brother be a fornicator or covetous or an idolater or railer, or drunkard, or an extortioner, with such an one know not to eat. 1 Corinthians 5:11. Jesus was accused of eating regular meals with sinners. See Matthew 9:11 and Mark 2:16. Yet, communion is not observed like a regular everyday meal, which is one of the arguments Paul makes against the Corinthians who had turned the communion into a drunken feast. Paul instructs the Corinthians not to eat with those who were walking after the flesh, and this has to refer to communion, not regular everyday meals. This gives us some insight that the participants of this observance should be restricted. The first qualification would have to be a person who's entered into the church through water baptism, thus signifying they had put on Christ and had put off the old man with his deeds. This person would have to examine his walk before he partakes of communion. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. 1 Corinthians 11:28. However, if one's self-examination does not agree with how the church judges his walk, the authority of the church is to have precedence over the individual's view. Reflecting deeply on how great things the Lord has done for us in sacrificing his body and shedding his blood for us is something we each need to do. We should not enter into this service unworthily. Otherwise, we will be eating and drinking damnation to ourselves, not discerning the Lord's body. See 1 Corinthians 11:29. The definition of the word communion means to share in common or fellowship. The scripture is clear to teach us that we are to exercise discernment when it comes to fellowship. And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. Ephesians 5:11. We are not to fellowship or commune with those that are not walking in the light. Paul goes on to say, And be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness, and what communion hath light with darkness? 2 Corinthians 6:14. We clearly see that we're not to be unequally yoked with unbelievers. We're not to fellowship unrighteousness or commune with darkness. This certainly embraces many of those that don't belong to the Lord and are outside the church. But what about those that belong to other Christian denominations? Should they be allowed to commune with us? Can we be divided doctrinally and still commune? Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you have learned, and avoid them. Romans 16:17. Paul clearly tells us to mark those that cause division contrary to doctrine and avoid them. If we are obedient to follow this admonition, it would be impossible to commune with that person. This is why a person that claims to be a Christian cannot commune with those of other orders. If there come any unto you and bring not this doctrine, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed. 2 John 1:10. John clearly teaches us that if we don't abide in the doctrine of Christ, we transgress. Further, we're not to receive anyone that does not abide in the doctrine. Again, under such circumstances, it would be unscriptural to commune with someone who's not abiding in the doctrine of Christ. Paul tells us, you cannot drink of the cup of the Lord and the cup of devils. You cannot be partakers of the Lord's table and of the table of devils. 1 Corinthians 10:18. We can't follow the world and its idolatry Monday through Saturday and come into the Lord's house and commune on Sunday. Doing so provokes the Lord. So hopefully by now you can see the need to exercise close communion. It shows that we are discerning the Lord's body and that we respect the teachings of His Word. Further, each of us should respect and recognize that each local church body has a biblical right to govern its own affairs without outside intervention. This is called church autonomy. We have no other authority on the earth. Our headquarters is in heaven, where Jesus, the head of the church, resides. It is Jesus and His teachings we desire to follow. Now, there's no biblical mandate that governs the frequency of communion other than as often as you do it. It's said that it was done on the first day of the week. Now, I have no scriptural argument if someone wants to do it every week, nor is there a valid argument to do it every week. Now, just because it was done on the first day of the week and collections for the saints were done on the same day and were made frequently doesn't prove we should commune every Sunday. As often as you do it does not endorse one position or the other. Primitive Baptists feel if it were done every week that the people would begin to take it for granted. So most Primitive Baptist churches observe it twice a year. Many also observe foot washing as taught in John chapter 13 to conclude their communion service. Now, in closing, I'd like to say that the church should always seek to follow biblical principles rather than personal preferences. Principles can unify people where preferences can divide us. I largely suspect that this is why many today have abandoned close communion for open communion, personal preferences. May God always give us grace and encourage us to stand upon the time-tested, solid principles of His Word. Now, for more information, I invite you to visit our website at www.paradisepbc.org. Feel free to email me with any questions or comments you may have. Now, as always, I ask that you search the Scriptures for yourself to see if what I'm saying is true. I'm Elder Keith Ellis, and until the next time, may the Lord richly bless you.